Hello everybody, it is 2:59 p.m. Central Time on Saturday, August 13th, 2016. Quickly jumping on here to just talk about something that's happening currently across the globe, halfway around the world, over here in the West Pacific and down here in the Southeast Pacific. We can also get into the West Coast, which is several thousand miles away from my location, but people elsewhere around the planet are probably concerned about this. So let's just run down what's happened recently over the past few hours. Let's turn on the last 24-hour feed from the USGS, all right? Here we go. All right, since last night, and now we're going into almost 24 hours since my update last night, we'll run down the earthquakes which struck in US and South America. Now, you notice, see down here in South America, there's only one earthquake listed by the USGS in the last 24 hours. See that? All right, now, let's go turn on the European feed only. And this is the last 50 earthquakes reported by the Europeans, so this is less than 24 hours. And in the past 24 hours, there's a 4, but a whole swarm of upper 3s, some of these going up into 4 and downgraded to 3.9. Now make note of where the swarm is occurring there. See that? It's at pretty much the south middle portion of the edge of the plate, bordering with the Pacific. All right? Now look to the north, up here in the United States. See how this is occurring right along the mountain range on the edge of the plate? Well, same thing is occurring in North America, right? Now, if you could see in between these two points with the feed, we don't have it. Not all the earthquakes in Central America are reported, the smaller earthquakes. But if you could, you can go check the agencies to verify this, guys. There's several 2s and 3s striking in a swarm right here. So really, we have 2s, 3s, and 4s striking in swarms all up the eastern Pacific in the last 24 hours. Okay, now over to the west. You see this? See the 5.0 and 5.2? Okay, these are European reported earthquakes. Now let's turn back on the USGS last 24-hour feed. And they only have one of the 5s listed. So the USGS omitting a 5 again. So let's turn back on the European feed since it's more accurate. I just want to show this to you real time. So why did 2.5 strike here? Well, you have to go back several days to this deep earthquake that happened. And let's, or the large and deep earthquake. Here's the last 7-day feed. Well, semi-deep. I mean, you know, more than 10 kilometers, less than 100. We have our deep earthquakes over here, and then we have our large 7.7. Did I say deep 7.7? I meant to say large 7.7, struck over here a few days ago. Now we're seeing pressure transfer over to the west, right along the fault zone, right at the fulcrum point in the middle of that silent zone over the last couple days, because take a look at it. Okay, here's the last 24 hours of earthquakes, right in the middle of that point. And we talked about North Philippines being the start of our silent zone, and the middle of our silent zone being the spot we're watching for a larger release to occur. And it hasn't been struck yet up here in Japan, but the 5s are carrying on as expected. Okay? So now, one more time, switch back feeds again. USGS last 24 hours, not showing us a complete picture, but going to show us the activity in the United States. Now, when you see the swarms in the US, and then you take into account the swarm down in South America and the swarm in Central America, each given away by a 4.5 reported by the USGS, right? Each location, there's swarms happening on the East Pacific because of the 7.7 a day ago, and it's spreading out across the whole East Pacific. Well, this definitely means that right in the middle, we should see a larger earthquake strike in the near term. And the middle point, well, I mean, it starts all, I mean, the point starts all the way up here to the north in our silent zone off the coast of the northwest and goes all the way down here to the 4.5. So the middle zone right there would pretty much be next to the 4.5 and 4.8 or 4.3. Is that a 3 or an 8? 3. Okay, so middle of the East Pacific should be struck. Why do I say that? We have 3 simultaneous swarms going on. And we should see the middle of this whole plate move as compensation for the 7 that struck over here a couple days ago. Now, it could just spread out in more swarms. That's what we hope for. We hope that the swarms relieve the pressure. they may go up in number dramatically, especially on the west coast of the U.S. Take a look at it. All those twos and threes. Now, this brings us into the west coast. Let's run down the west coast, show you what's going on. Now, you're going to notice earthquakes over here to the east. And I ran over these earlier today, talking about the fracking operations in Texas. Snyder, Texas was struck. Okay, so Snyder, Texas. Here, let me turn on a screen share so you guys can see the back end of what I'm looking at here. Here we go. So Snyder, Texas was struck. You go look this location up. It's a large fracking operation. I'm not going to waste your time with that. Same with up in Oklahoma. So the 2.2 up at a fracking operation. But see this spot over here at North Georgia? The 2.2 along the eastern edge of the craton? Let's open that up. Happening at 14 kilometer depth. Now, I've got to show this location to you because people on the East Coast are going to be shocked to see what's there. And I had to discover this myself. All right. Nobody told me about this. This was something that I found on my own when earthquakes struck here back in 2011 and 2012. Everybody mocked and ridiculed the discovery until it was confirmed. And let me show you how it was confirmed. All right. So here are the coordinates. Let's put them in from the USGS. This is amazing. Again, listen up, people. Take a look. This is cool. We have an earthquake striking here, and let me show you what's going on. Okay. All right. See Chattanooga here, right? See the edge of the craton here. Let me turn off the borders really quick. Okay, the edge of the craton, you can make it out. It's in the plate itself. These long lines extending, those are mountain ranges. And we're going to zoom in on the area, and you see this marked spot here? All right, we saw a swarm strike nearby here, just like this earthquake striking now, only multiple twos. I came in on the area and was like, what are we looking at here? This formation here in the edge of the craton, it has like a round shape to it. It goes down to an old lava flow that's on the edge. Now they've updated the picture here and it's got more trees. So let me show you what I saw at the time. We have to go back in time. Luckily we can do this with the imagery with Google. Check this out. Okay, here's an old black and white imagery, but I'm going to take you up to like when I started to notice what was going on here. Okay, here's 2010. Let's go forward. Is this the image? I believe, yeah, this is it. Okay. So when I'm looking at it, this is 2012. Here we go. And I'm looking at the area and I'm like, wow, this really stands out. This looks like one of our old weathered buttes from back in the day when we're looking, and there weren't volcano place marks put out by the Smithsonian or Google yet. So we were just going by what we were looking at in, you know, for tuffs. We were looking for old lava flows and ridges that rise up. And I looked at this and I thought, wow, this looks like a volcanic chain. And I said so. And everybody mocked and ridiculed it. And that caused me to look into it further. So I looked up the area and I didn't find much information. I found a thing called Pigeon Mountain Eruption in Georgia back in the 1800s, an old newspaper article talking about how there was this glowing fumarole that appeared and it caused a fire, and then it was out by the next day and nobody knew what caused it. Well, that all being said, I got really curious and I got trolled really hard on it because everybody said there was no volcano. And I decided to do a street level view just to see if there was anything nearby. And Google had driven their car all the way down the road right to the entrance of this mine that's on the side of here, right? So I did the Google thing and I went in on street level and I came in on the area and I saw this sign here at the entrance to the mine and it says Vulcan. And the company that's mining there is called the Vulcan Mining Company, and it's indeed an old volcano. All right, so I marked it myself. I downloaded the Google Earth Placemark KMZ program and marked this sucker myself and uploaded it, and it was approved because it's proved now, right? I mean, the Vulcan Mining Company there, and then it's part of an old volcanic chain. And so you see this formation here. This is the volcano, and this is a mine on the side of the volcano. You can even make out the old volcanic rock and the nature of that, the gray ash that probably compacted over time there. And it's on the edge of the craton. So there's our earthquake. Now, why is there an earthquake striking there now? Why is there a volcano there now? Well, look at the bend. See this? Okay. We really have to back this out. And let me turn this off and bring it back to current imagery. Let's turn off all my placemarks, and you'll only see the craton. Okay. So the craton goes all the way up the East Coast. You can see it defined very well with the mountains. Well, it becomes a little less defined down here to the south where it makes the bend, but you can still see it. And this is a rise of about 500 feet across about 100 miles. And it bends up, and then it goes up here to the north. And see this? Let me turn the borders back on now. This goes up into the New Madrid seismic zone. Right here at the bend here, this is the New Madrid and Wabash Valley seismic zone. And it's formed a depression that the river follows down to the south. But the bend in the edge of the craton right there is obvious. But it doesn't go all the way down to New Orleans. It actually, right here, picks back up across Arkansas. Let me turn the borders back on. This is amazing, guys. You got to pay attention to what I'm talking about here so you can understand why earthquakes are striking on the East Coast right now. So here's the formation. Again, the edge of the craton, just like over on the East Coast. Take a look. Compare this here in Arkansas over to this here on the East Coast. It's the same thing, right? Now get this. Down in Arkansas, look what's right on the edge of the craton. Crater of Diamond State Park. And this is a volcano. Old volcano, weathered down over time. But take a look at it. See this round formation here? This is the whole volcano. They have the state park here where they're plowing out the field on the edge of the lava flow that used to exist here. And you can go in to the state park and pay a certain fee to dig in the ground and find these diamonds. And the largest diamonds found in North America have been found there. Just happened again last year. But this whole thing is a volcano. And then we zoom in at the center and take a look what's right at the center. The Old Butte with a cone still inside. Now, nobody's discovered this yet. They all think that the volcano's over here to the west. I did the appropriate thing on here and figured out this is the volcano and the center is right there, which means there's probably more diamonds all the way around here. And So anyways, that's the volcano there, right along the edge of the craton. Again, because it's a weak spot, this has happened for millennia. These are very, very old, if not older. And so the pressure is always transferred across this. Now let me turn my place marks back off and turn off the borders and labels. Okay, so we carry on the edge of the craton here and then see this, see where it goes north? See this, it's almost like a line that goes due north. Well, you can actually see right here, it makes a bend. See the bend right here? And we can go into the center and you'll find more volcanic formations, ancient volcanoes. These are valleys in between here. But we get down here to the south, take a look. It bends down to the south and goes across Dallas, right? Well, it becomes very undefined across there until you get down to the south where it makes another bend. But the elevation rise here is 1,000 feet. It goes from 400 feet here to 1,450 feet here in a stretch just 150 miles across Texas. This is a rise in the edge of the craton and it bends down to the south. It cuts across Fort Stockton here, and then see how the mountains start going north? It bends and goes back up to the north and makes up the front range of the mountains. It actually splits down to the south where all our volcanoes are. Now let me turn my place markers back on. It splits, and where the split occurred, look at where all the volcanoes are going over into Oklahoma. Each one of these, Carrizo Mountain, Black Mesa Volcanic Butte. We have several cones down here. I mean, these are really cool. If you guys ever wanted to go down and check it out, these cones are actually being mined. Some of them are being mined on the sides. So you can still make out. I mean, take a look at that, right? I mean, that's relatively young. But these are right at the Oklahoma border, and there's so many. It goes up into Colorado, down into New Mexico, and right along where the plate bends, that's where all the volcanoes formed. All the way up the front range, not just... We can go in and look at these. Here's Dotsero volcano out there in the middle of Colorado, but there's so many more. There's so many more. Check this one out. Just like Dotsero, only nobody knows about it being an old volcano. You can even make out the old basalt tuft on the top of that where it flowed out in the past at some point. But it keeps going north. Keeps going north all the way to where? Yellowstone. Where we have our super volcano here at Lake Yellowstone. Here, along the northwest edge of the craton, which then carries up and becomes more defined, like over on the East Coast. And then our mountain ranges here give away the edge of the craton. It bends again, goes up to the north, bends again, goes up to the northwest. And at our bend here, we've got our dome formation that we discovered, which is this oval dome-shaped formation here, an oval dome-shaped formation here, and right in the middle, we've got Uraniumville, or what was the name of this place? Uranium City? Is that the name of it? Yeah, Uranium City. Uranium City there. So we have large uranium deposits up in these domes that exist on the eastern edge of the craton, which again form from upwelling pressure coming from the northwest and pushing to the east-southeast. And the volcanoes show the tail of it. They even make that U shape down to the south, all the different volcanoes. Where this, imagine this, guys. Think about this. All these volcanoes, see how they go in a U shape down to the south? Down here, this whole thing was an inland ocean. You can even see the old watermarks here. And over to the west. But you can even see the old watermarks here where this was all contained in an inner ocean. These volcanoes probably rose up like Hawaii in chains and trapped this inland ocean here. And then at some point in the past, it broke out here and then flowed out through the Grand Canyon. And that's what gave us Grand Canyon, not the Colorado River. They got it all wrong. And then to seal the deal as to whether or not there was an inland ocean here that drained out, you can still make out the Great Salt Lake used to extend all the way over to here and connected to all these salt lakes. And you can imagine these rose up. It was probably like the Caribbean, whatever, that this was probably light blue, beautiful water going all the way down here. And at some point in the past, this flowed out and you can see the direction it flowed. This isn't wind erosion. This is the direction that the overall flow occurred. And then along there, we have what more deformation that occurred with hundreds, if not thousands of volcanoes that make up the edge of this where it flowed out in the past. So the whole story you've been told about the formation of the plate, the way it formed, it rose out of the ocean and it trapped an inland sea here that flowed out through the Grand Canyon. The Colorado River just you can even see the section that blew out here or collapsed or whatever that allowed the flow to begin. And the inland ocean that existed all throughout here drained out and down through the Grand Canyon, which deposited huge amounts of sand, and it flowed down here to the south. And that's what gives us all the sand down here to the south as it drained out. Over to the east, you can also make out that there was something that happened. Maybe there was a dramatic uplift event that could also have occurred. Craton became under huge amount of pressure, which caused an uplift to occur, and the whole ocean drained out. You can even make out the areas where the badlands occur, and we have sand that makes all this up. These sand badlands in North Dakota, South Dakota, Nebraska, and the flow coming off of that is obvious where there was water in the past that flowed out of there, but it was so long ago. So again, the whole story you know about plate formation is wrong. There was no Pangaea. That each continent rose out of the sea, and it happened in Central America too. Take a look at all the volcanoes down to the south along their edge of their craton. Proof that this all rose. Every one of these is a volcano, guys. Every splotch you see on here and all the little ones in between, every one of them is a different volcano. Proof that this formed in the past from a dramatic uplift. Whether it was Central America, and this goes down throughout, not just Mexico. If I turn my place marks back on, you'll see Smithsonian's got larger volcanic centers marked all the way down. It's proof. So there's no subduction going on at all. The Pacific plate is not bending down and going underneath the North American plate, contrary to what they say the soundings show, that the waves reflect off a bent surface underneath our plate. All that's underneath our plate is magma. And the same thing is underneath the Pacific plate, magma. They don't slip underneath each other. They're actually pressing right up against one another. And where they press up, that's where the volcanoes form, is the upwelling pressure has nowhere to go. And I want to show that to you. Here's the Juan de Fuca off the coast of the Pacific Northwest. Everybody knows about it and talks about it. They call it the Cascadia subduction zone. BS. No subduction going on. These are side-by-side plates that meet up. And there's fractures that occur, and it's obvious. You can see the fracture point here, right? See the fracture point here and how the Gorda escarpment is just another fracture point, and it goes all the way out here into the Pacific, out towards Hawaii. Now, see the shape. Remember the Z or V shape and the fault line next to it. Now, let's go south. right off the coast of Mexico. See the Z shape? Right? See this? And see the fault zone that goes to the west? This is my discovery, nobody else's. And this fault zone connecting to the Z shape here, again, proof that we're just seeing pressure transfer across from the Pacific over to the east, and it hits the plate here, the North American, Central American, even far up into Canada, and it has nowhere to go. It doesn't subduct, never has, because you have ancient volcanoes and cliffs and everything else that have been here the whole time. They haven't gone anywhere. Ancient, meaning there is no subduction on either side. Otherwise, these old formations would have disappeared. Right? And not only that, the earthquakes progress. Let's jump back over to earthquake 3D. Earthquakes progress across the plate from west to east. Take a look at it. West coast, Midwest, East coast. And it strikes along the edge of the craton. It pushes towards the mid-Atlantic. Now let's get back over to Google Earth. Debunking all of plate tectonics right now. Take a listen. They say the mid-Atlantic ridge spreads and that lava somehow comes up out of here and forms these ridges going north and south, and it upwells and spreads out in each direction and pushes North America and Africa, the whole European plate, pushes them apart. Well, that would be maybe acceptable if we didn't have lateral fracture zones that go east and west. And these are all considered fracture zones. If we turn on our place marks, you guys are welcome to come in and check out their name, the Atlantis fracture zone, for instance, right here. The fracture zones are proof that pressure is coming towards the mid-Atlantic and pressing inwards like a sandwich, not pressing outwards and growing outwards. It's pressing inwards. The lateral fracture zones match up to where the two plates are going towards each other. And people say, oh, South America and Africa look like they fit together. Well, that would be okay if you added several billion years to the age of the universe and if you rotated Africa and shrunk it by 30%. Oh yeah, and by the way, the geologic column doesn't match up either, so there is no, they were connected. This rose out of the sea, just like Africa rose out of the sea. And they're all pretty much stationary, with the plates not moving very much at all, but the interior portions of the plate moving, rising and pressing upwards, allowing for uplift, which allows then for lateral movement to the east or to the west or to the north or to the south as it's pressing up. It's rising. All of North America is rising. And California rose out of the sea. It had an inland sea trapped in here in the Sacramento and San Joaquin Valley. You can make out the watermark on that. You don't have to take my word for it. You can look up the ancient inland ocean that existed here. This rose out of the sea as well. And California never has to worry about sinking or falling into the ocean, because guess what? There's nothing to fall into. You have a gradual slope several hundred miles out to sea that goes out to a few thousand feet down. Your highest mountain peaks wouldn't even go down, even if you did slide somehow. So what does that mean? Well, that means there's no subduction. There's no empty space for you to fall into. You can't slide out into the ocean because there's nowhere for you to slide. And these ancient volcanoes out here let you know they've always been there. Look, they're just in a small little line. Proof that the magma chamber down below has been slightly moved over time, but the plate has stayed in the same spot. Same with Hawaii. Think about this, guys. The plate hasn't moved. The magma chamber has. The plate's not moving in the directions they say it is. The ancient volcanoes out here prove it. And the fact that there's new little volcanoes forming all around is more proof that the plate's not moving, that the magma chambers move. And you can see the direction the magma chambers down below, because that's the moving part. It's not the crust rotating around on top of a magma chamber, on top of the magma down below in the crust or in the mantle. It's not that the plate is staying put. The Earth is rotating, of course. Outside, if you're looking at the outside, the Earth is rotating. On the inside, the plate is staying put, and then we have more rotation going on, most likely in the opposite direction, I don't know. But, and that the magma chambers move over time, in line. And it gives you these new progression and lines of volcanoes. And the line of Hawaiian volcanoes matches up with the lines of the other volcanoes we see on land that happen in clusters and progressions in long strings. A perfect example of this, let's show you that. A perfect example of the string of volcanoes is up here in Oregon. Now take a look at this. This is not along, well, it's next to a fault zone, but this is not along the Craton edge. Now look at the progression of volcanoes here. Starting to the south, we have number 37, correct? Or maybe I should start with number 1 and get down to number 37 since we're going back in time. All right, so we got number 1 up here, the most recent, huge. Mount Bachelor has erupted in the past, not too long ago. We can look up the eruptive history on this. Here we go. All right. 7,700 years ago, they have some stuff here listed. It's 7,700 years, 18,000 years ago formation. So 7,700 years ago, large explosive blast off this. We have other more recent cones that don't even have trees on them down around here, proof that this is part of a string of volcanoes. And of course, they connect into the edge of the overall plate. But now take a look. As we go south, we have cone after cone, and they're weathered down over time. They're older as we get down to the south. Okay, so I'm going to show you these lines so you can understand the more recent ones. Like here's a lava flow extending out from these two cones here, 2, 3, and 4. This one's still collapsed, and the basalt and volcanic rock are still in there, and there's only a few trees. Okay, but you can see the lava flow extends off here to the east, still visible. Here's 4 and 5. This probably should be two different ones marked here. Here's another one here. Here's 7. That should be 7 and 8. That's two more there. But so there's 8. Here's 9. Again, younger. Off to the side, we've got another one. Here's a smaller one. Check it out. Happened again more recently. Probably a smaller uplift event at some point in the past. Each one of these, look at this crater here. Another one right next to it. And again, an old lava flow off of it. Go further down to the south. More younger volcanoes, not weathered as much. More weathered here. More weathered here. More weathered, getting older as we go back in time here. Now, what does this mean? The magma chamber has moved that much over time, producing all of these. And then it stops, and you can see where it stops. So we'll keep going down. 34, 35. And then it kind of just fizzles out right here with our last little old butte weathered and collapsed over time. Okay? And next to it is an even older one, proof that it happened again sometime in the past. Again, upwelling pressure coming from down below and pushing in a progression. But that means the plate stayed in the same spot. Plate stayed in the same spot. Magma chamber had to move. That's amazing. It's a huge discovery. So overall, once again, West Coast activity transfers along the edge of the Craton. It goes from the West Coast to the Midwest fracking operations to get struck over and over again. And we just had another swarm. I can show you a frack well just to give you an example of what they look like. There's so many of them. Here's one where they're actually in 2015 still doing the drilling. They've got the stack up, they've got the pipes in, they've got all the guys there doing the drilling. Right next to it, we've got one that's already been completed. Same thing, all right? They're just freshly fracking that one in 20, and it's so many, I got tired of marking them, and they just go on for miles. See all these little pads? I mean, they're not all marked, but every one of them is a different frack well. So those locations get struck, and they're the weak spot that man has created along the edge of the Craton. So as I showed you, then we get over to the east, and this ties us all back together where I started. I had to go into the whole explanation so you can understand why. Pressure transfers along the edge of the Craton over to the east, and then when it hits the bend, that's when we see another round of earthquakes right at the bend. And the bend goes from roughly at the Flat Rock Point Pigeon Mountain Volcano down here to the fracking operations around Tuscaloosa. So just be aware that that's happening. In Alabama, we've got oil pumping operations, guys. Check it out. Take a look. All starting at Tuscaloosa, going up to the north where I had all those other place marks. Every one of these is a different oil or gas frack well. and they're extracting gas by injecting. So anyways, so it goes right along the edge of the craton. That's where the earthquakes strike. And we have to watch further up the edge of the craton, and this goes up to the East Coast. Usually the next spot that struck is near New Jersey. Let's show in and go in and show you where New Jersey is. Where do we, what do we have right there? Well, just to the west, we have our bend in the craton. And then it strikes here in New Jersey. And mystery booms and rumbles happen here. Well, is there any wonder? Look what's to your west. A bend point in the edge of the plate. Mystery booms and rumbles are going to happen all throughout here as the plate bends and rises. It then goes up to the north, and this is the most interesting thing. See the split here? It then starts going down in elevation. The split goes out here into the ocean, where you can even see it carry on out all the way. And it looks like a channel here. This isn't a man-made channel. They didn't dredge this out. This is huge, and it's the edge of the craton going out into the ocean. On the western edge, you guys may see this. There's evidence of past dome collapses, just like over in western Canada along the edge of the craton. On eastern Canada on the edge of the craton, you have more dome-shaped collapses that occurred over time. And you can make out the dome shape here, all right? And you can make out the circular shape here where that actually collapsed in the past. And literally, in western Canada, that's where I started out. Look. Here's the dome here. See this dome here? You might have to zoom it in a little bit. Okay, see the dome here? It's actually bordered on the north by the shape of the lake. And there's another one to the north. Let's show you. Here, you see the edge, the oval edge on here? Okay, let's just start up here and show that to you. Going around here. Okay, that's a dome shape. And it rises exactly 1,000 feet. This one's 500 feet. It rises 500 feet exactly to the center. So it rises up into a dome. And then this one down to the south is much more pronounced, starting up at Lake Athabasca and goes around like this. And it does the same thing. It rises to the very center and then rises back down to the other side, or drops down to the other side. It's a dome shape. Now look what's just west of there. So we're just, let's go down to the center of this dome. And we've got, look at our coordinates in the lower corner. 58 north, 107 west, all right? 58 north, all right? Now we go right on over, and where do we have our circular formations? This one's at 51, okay? So just a few degrees off. So we're talking about up here to the north, this, and it's along the edge of the plate. See, look where it resides on the in relation to the edge of the craton. So it's just to the east here, and over here, it's just to the west here. Proof that, and maybe even Hudson Bay was one of these old dome, you can kind of make out the shape on this. Maybe it was. Maybe it collapsed in the past at some point, or started to depress instead of rise as the pressure came in. Because again, it presses upwards. So it's pressing up and it's going to the east or west, sometimes to the southeast. Same with Yellowstone. Let's use Yellowstone as an example for our US viewers. Yellowstone gets pushed up from underneath and pushed to the east-southeast. It moved 9 inches. 9 inches in a few years' time to the east-southeast. That's from GPS measurements. I want to say in 1 6-month stretch, it moved 3 inches to the east-southeast in 6 months' time. The whole region, not just Yellowstone, I'm talking the whole area around Idaho, Wyoming, Montana, measured to push east-southeast by multiple inches in a few months' time. That's from the USGS. I got the stats on my page from the GPS measurements. It's insane. Well, if it's moving to the east-southeast, where's it going? Doesn't that mean the whole plate is going to move to the east-southeast? You're damn right it will. And what's that going to do if it pushes 3 inches in a few months' time to the east-southeast? What's east-southeast of Yellowstone? Oh, I don't know. All the fracking operations across Colorado, Texas, Oklahoma, and Kansas. So the pressure will press from up here at Yellowstone to the east-southeast, and that 3-inch movement that occurred displaces all the fracking operations, everything over to the east by 3 inches as well. Or maybe it doesn't press by 3 inches. Maybe it just goes 1 inch or a half inch. But a half inch pressure on a frack well is going to cause an earthquake. They have to have some leeway on that pressure. Depressurize those wells so that they can, you know, like a shock absorber, absorb that as opposed to being fully pressurized, extracting the ultimate amount of gas. So I hope this little explanation has kind of opened your eyes a little bit to, the difference in what I teach between me and the others. All of modern day geology is wrong. I've disproved it. The core of the Earth is plasma energy, not solid. Radio waves created the plasma energy, by the way. We can go into that, how the Earth formed, how the plasma formed originally at the formation of the solar system, when the sun was forming, and how what happens when plasma radio waves focused intersects with clouds of hydrogen and oxygen. So, in other words, when Earth formed, most likely, a plasma core first was ejected from the sun or part of the leftover remnants of the sun, and the plasma energy, which is nothing more than a electron cascade by intersecting radio waves. This could be easily done naturally when the sun was forming. And the plasma had to have intersected clouds of hydrogen and oxygen, since that's abundant elements. And when the hydrogen and oxygen clouds, nebula, were intersected by plasma energy, as we know from HARP experiments, ironically, that induces water molecule formation. That the hydrogen and oxygen latch on to the small ions of the plasma, and it forms water molecule chains, steam, cloud formation, and water droplets. Now imagine that happening on a massive level out in the early solar system, and then all of a sudden, what would you have? Well, since the plasma is superheated, and the H2O that's hitting it would immediately vaporize into a gas, all of a sudden, you would have a gaseous water that would freeze, and then the plasma would melt it, and next thing you know, you have plasma encased by a layer of liquid, superheated liquid water, and steam going out God knows how far, forming a primordial atmosphere. But it's just water and plasma. That's it. But guess what water carries with it? Weight. That's right. Water and mass. All of a sudden, you're turning a gaseous nebula into a giant weight in the universe, in the solar system, I'm sorry. And this mass of water floating in space like a giant globule most likely was frozen around the outside like a casement around with inner liquid water steaming and boiling hot going down how many miles? And then guess what? Now that it's got gravity and it's got an electromagnetic field from the plasma, guess what it's going to start attracting? Meteorites that are rocky and filled with metals. And next thing you know, those meteorites crash through that ice shell and sink down to the plasma core and are immediately vaporized themselves, since the plasma core is hot enough to melt anything, and all of a sudden you've got liquid magma. The liquid magma, though, is hitting the water, which will then form a shell like we see with the layers of rock and the crust. And over time, as more meteorites fall, they sink down in this ocean. They then get taken into the core of the Earth and melted. They'll fracture through that light shell of crust, the primordial crust down at the bottom of the oceans, which explains for how there were upwelling continents as more matter came in, floats down to the bottom of the ocean. Ocean is just nothing but a plasma bottom at this point, and you are able to get rising magma that hardens and forms into these ancient plates. And then the rest of the geology got it wrong, and the plates were never connected in a Pangaea. Now, there may have been less water. That makes sense to me, that water would have been trapped at some point in the past in between some of these layers. And that explains for the ancient legends of water coming up out of the ground and huge floods, out of nowhere. And it would also explain the ancient legends of there being ice crystals around ancient Earth. This goes into some seriously, seriously weird science at this point. Because then you go back in time and you start to see that there was less water on the planet back when these things happened, but then there's accounts of water coming up out of the ground from the deep, which means, and they find ancient oceans are actually contained in these rocks. That's a finding from a couple of years ago, that nanoparticles of water are contained in the rocks going down into the crust that account for another ocean's worth of water. And I was like, what? When I'm reading that, I'm like, okay, well, that means there was ancient water that was around when the rocks were forming, not a volcanic past like geology says, that it was a burning ball, and then the burning ball cooled down, and then water fell. It must have been a comet that brought water in, and you know, then it fell to the earth, and then the primordial ooze formed. That's all a BS story. That we come from primordial ooze. I mean, come on. Anyways, that this primordial ooze formed plant life, and you know, with the dinosaurs, and come on. You know, oil doesn't come from dinosaurs or plant life, right? You know that, right? That the oil deposits are multiple kilometers down in the ground. Multiple kilometers down, guys. And there's no accounting for dinosaurs to be multiple kilometers down in the ground. Hello? Dinosaurs are not multiple kilometers down in the ground. Neither is plant life. Nor was it ever there. So that means oil is abiotic, which means the whole story, you know, how Sinclair Oil has their dinosaur as their logo. Well, that's baloney. Okay? It has to be. There's no way dinosaurs could be 5 km below the surface producing oil. There's no way. 5 km down is right along the borderline edge of the plate where we're starting to get it down into hot levels where there's, you know, magma a few km below that. So please, spare 20 kilometers more down, you're actually at a viscous magma depth. So this is just insane to believe the things that are taught in geology. And I think I've pretty much debunked a lot of it at this point, especially with the earthquake progression across the plate in the opposite direction. The plate's not moving. There's just earthquakes that transfer across the edge of the plate, and the plate moves upwards. When it moves upwards, it's then allowed to move east, north, south, west. But really, it's just going up and east, up and north, up and south, up and west, depending on which plate we're talking about around the world. It's like a skyscraper going up and at an angle. You know, there's nowhere for these plates to go. They're not going underneath each other, and they're not falling into each other. They butt up against each other like plates on a sheet of ice. They're not, and there is no way for them to go underneath each other because they're both really thick. And that's all she wrote on plate tectonics. That's all she wrote on Pangaea, which is nothing more than a BS, I don't know, a BS story created by people who didn't have the tools to observe the planet properly. And everybody went with it in the 17, 18, and early 1900s. Even into the mid-century, and it was inappropriate to make declarations about what is and is not when the science wasn't in on it. You know? To go with an old, outdated Lyell geologic column. I mean, Lyell with his whole principles of volcanism or volcanology, whatever. That whole book is based and predicated on a lie. And that's what the foundations of geology come from? Lyell's work, the fake geologic column that he made up? Come on. Come on, we're debunking it all. And that's why there's such a stink and such a stir about everything I do and everything I say online. That's why they all have to weigh in. That's why the biggest names came against me and why Big Solar came on the attack in the past couple days. Have a good one, guys. Hope you got a little lesson out of all that.